Hello friends, my name is JJ, and a couple of weeks ago I asked you guys to pick the topic of my next video, and the most upvoted request was for me to tell the story of the history of Canadian social credit. So, here we go. For as long as money has existed, it has been popular to hate and fear bankers. Because banks are the things that control our access to money, and because most of us don't have as much money as we would like, it is very easy to assume that the shenanigans of the banking industry must have something to do with all of the economic problems of the modern world. As a result, every political populist movement, be it on the right or the left, will inevitably make demonization of banks one of the central parts of their pitch to voters.
If a bank is too big to fail, it is too big to exist.
Hillary Clinton meets in secret with international banks to plot the destruction of U.S. sovereignty in order to enrich these global financial powers.
So in the 1920s, there was this Scottish guy called Major Douglas, and by today's standards, we would say he was something like a freelance blogger. He wrote a number of self-published books and essays about the evils of the international banking system, the most famous of which was a book called Socialcredit, which was published in 1924. Douglas's pitch went something like this. Have you ever noticed how there's a lot more cool stuff in the stores than you can afford to buy? Why do you think that is? Well, the obvious answer is because your boss doesn't pay you enough money. But why doesn't he just pay you more? Well, he'd probably say it's because he needs to use that money for other stuff, like buying more machines for the factory or whatever. But those machines will be no good if no one has enough money to buy the things that they're making. Clearly, says Douglas, we are living in a society in which the production of goods is too high and the purchasing power of the individual is too low. This means we have all become slaves to credit and debt, and thus the parasitic banker class who control the money supply. The solution, he said, would be to fix prices to make goods more affordable, while also figuring out some way for government to give money to citizens directly. This would eliminate the need for an extortionist banking industry and put us on the path to a post-debt, post-scarcity utopia. This is the Douglas theory of social credit. Or at least it's something close to what he believed. The economic theories of Major Douglas, which are sometimes called Douglasism, are actually quite hard to understand today. Douglas made a lot of weird and dated assumptions about the nature of economics that we now know to be completely wrong and ignorant. It would be safe to say that as far as economic theories go, Douglasism has been quite solidly discredited. But back in the 1920s, Douglasism was quite popular, and people around the world formed social credit clubs to discuss his theories and complain about bankers. Douglasism really took off in Canada in particular, especially during the years of the Great Depression. The Depression hit rural Canada particularly hard, and there was a lot of appetite there for new economic theories to explain what had gone so wrong and what could be done to fix it. This is a man named William Eberhardt. He was a school teacher in rural Alberta and a big fan of Major Douglas and his theories. Eberhardt was also a huge Christian fundamentalist, and one of the reasons why he went for Douglasism was because it synced up so nicely with his broader apocalyptic worldview that saw bankers as literal agents of Satan trying to enslave humanity through debt and credit. During the 1920s, Eberhardt had his own radio show, the most popular Christian radio show in all of Western Canada. He would go on and on about the evils of the banking industry and how the end times were just around the corner and how only Douglasism would save us. In 1935, Eberhardt was elected Prime Minister of Alberta. Eberhardt had founded the Alberta Social Credit Party for the purpose of bringing the theories of Douglasism into government. Accordingly, as premier, he passed laws fixing the prices of goods and distributed these things to citizens: prosperity certificates, which were basically a form of Albertan money. But then in 1938, the Supreme Court of Canada ruled much of this unconstitutional on the grounds that only the Canadian federal government had jurisdiction over monetary policy. This proved a pretty serious blow to the idea of implementing Douglasism at the provincial level, and in many ways marked the end of the orthodox social credit movement in Canada. In 1943, Eberhardt died in office and was replaced by his right-hand man, Ernest Manning. And then in 1947, oil was discovered in Alberta, which caused a huge economic boom and has kept it one of the wealthiest parts of Canada ever since. This was basically the final nail in the coffin of social credit orthodoxy, since it basically eliminated the economic conditions that had resulted in someone as radical as Eberhardt getting elected in the first place. Ernest Manning, for his part, wound up being an incredibly popular premier in his own right. He was elected to an incredible 7 terms before retiring in 1968 to go off to work, wildly enough, for a bank. But this wasn't too hypocritical, because during its 25 years in power, the Social Credit Party of Alberta sort of gradually evolved into just a generically right-wing political party. Manning had turned away from Douglasism and instead come to associate with what was then the rising neoconservative movement of North America, which combined evangelical Christian morality with support for free market capitalism and opposition to socialism and communism. 1947 is sometimes held up as the year in which Douglasism was formally rejected, because that was the year that Premier Manning engaged in a kind of purge in which he removed any of the hardcore Douglasites from any position of political influence. The Social Credit Party remained, but only as Premier Manning's private personality cult. And as soon as he left office, no one really cared about the party anymore. In Alberta's 1971 election, the Social Credit Party was finally booted from power, and a few years later, the party just basically died. All of the former Social Credit politicians and voters migrated to the Conservatives, which believed all of the same things Manning did, but in a less weird party. Manning's son, by the way, Preston Manning, would go on to be a very important conservative Canadian politician as well, but that is another story. And what, you ask, ever happened to Major Douglas himself? Well, he was a strange and eccentric man, and as he got closer to his death in 1952, he only got more so. Like many people obsessed with the evils of banking, over time, Douglas started to drift away from monetary policy in favor of these elaborate conspiracy theories about how international banking was this huge evil plot by Freemasons and Jews to enslave the world. This sort of stuff also helped make a lot of people less interested in identifying with social credit. During their peak, the popularity of Premiers Eberhardt and Manning also saw the creation of a national social credit party, though this largely existed so the Albertans could vote for people allied with their provincial government to the federal parliament in Ottawa. Accordingly, in the 7 federal elections between 1935 and 1958, almost all of Alberta's members of parliament were members of the Social Credit Party. This fact even briefly made them the 3rd biggest political party in Canada, at least before the NDP started to take off. But echoing what had happened at the provincial level, after Premier Manning's retirement in 1968, Albertans stopped voting social credit at the federal level, and the National Party died off as a result. Or did it? So interestingly enough, Douglasism also proved quite popular in the province of Quebec. That it could be so popular in the 2 provinces of Canada we think of as being the most distinct from each other is a good example of how different paths can sometimes lead to the same place. Douglas's theories were attractive to English-Canadian prairie evangelical millennialist Protestants like Eberhardt, who saw the banking industry as a symbol of the sinfulness of the modern world. But those same theories were also popular with many French-Canadian Catholics who saw the banking industry as a symbol of the English-Canadian Protestant establishment that was keeping them poor and oppressed. Some might also say that late-era Douglasism, which like I said was quite conspiratorial and anti-Semitic, also found traction with a certain subculture of rural Quebecers who were inclined to that sort of thing. Sorry, Quebecers, please don't hate me. You know, anymore. Though the Quebec Social Credit Party, known as the Creditistes, did not have much success in provincial politics, they did have a lot of success in federal politics, and often elected more members of the national parliament than the Alberta Social Credit Party did. For a time, the two social credit parties, located on opposite ends of the country, worked together, with the Creditistes agreeing to be under the leadership of the Albertans. But by the 1960s, relations between the English and French factions of the party had become increasingly strained. Along with the obviously huge cultural differences, the fact that the Albertan social credit people had abandoned orthodox Douglasism caused tension with the Quebecers, who were a lot more hardcore. Here is a quote from Réal Couet, who was the most famous Quebec social credit politician.
I follow all of Douglas's theory 100%. They do not anymore. They are mostly a conservative organization which upholds the old traditions and doesn't move forward.
But it wound up being a moot point since, like I said, by the 1960s, most Albertans were not even voting social credit anymore anyway. This allowed Couet and the Creditistes to completely take over the Federal Social Credit Party for the final few years of its life. 1979 was the last time any social credit politicians were elected to the Canadian Parliament. They were four Quebecers. Couet had died a few years earlier, and the Creditistes found it hard to function without him. Hopefully by now you can see that much of the success of social credit was tied to the people that were leading it. And speaking of personality cults, let me just close by talking about the third and final part of Canada where social credit was successful, my province of British Columbia. So this is William Andrew Cecil Bennett, or W.A.C. Bennett, as everybody called him. He was a hardware store owner from rural British Columbia who was elected as a conservative member of the B.C. Parliament in the 1940s. But W.A.C. Bennett was a man of greater ambitions than he felt the Conservative Party could handle. So in 1951, he quit the Conservatives to take over what was then the quite small and unpopular BC Social Credit Party and make it his own political vehicle. Bennett was very influenced by Premier Manning in Nextdoor Alberta, who by 1951, of course, had already purged the Alberta Social Credit Party of the Douglasites. So the BC Social Credit Party was always way more Manningite than Douglasite, a sort of populist conservative Christian party that mostly existed to provide one man with an opportunity to provide his province with strong leadership. Bennett was elected Prime Minister of British Columbia in 1953, and like his mentor Manning, would also go on to serve an incredible 7 terms. I think most historians would say that he was probably the best premier in British Columbia history, just because he was very much associated with like the post-war modernization of the province and like the construction of new highways and hospitals and power plants and that sort of thing. W.A.C. Bennett was eventually replaced as premier by his son, Bill Bennett Jr., who continued to run a broadly conservative government throughout the 1970s and 80s. But then in the late 1980s, the wheels started to fall off everything a bit. Bennett was replaced as premier in 1986 by Bill Vanderzam, who was this sort of flamboyant Trump-type character who had won control of the party in a surprise upset. For reasons I won't get into here, he proved to be an incredibly unpopular guy in power and eventually resigned in scandal and more or less destroyed the reputation of the BC Social Credit Party overnight. In the 1991 BC election, the Social Credit Party came in a distant third. And in the years that followed, all of the remaining Social Credit Party politicians defected to other political parties. No Social Credit Party politician was ever elected, ever again. In fact, by the early 2000s, there was no longer any evidence that the Social Credit Party, the party that had previously ruled British Columbia for much of the last 35 years, had ever existed. So that's it, the history of the Canadian Social Credit thing. Was this a good story? Does it remind you of the story of any other political party you've heard of? Let me know in the comments, like this video if you enjoyed it, and I will see you all next week.
Do you feel that the people understood the principles or just were so anxious to find some kind of a solution?
I don't think they understood anything about it. And he told them on occasion not to worry about that. You don't have to understand the philosophy of social credit to enjoy the benefits of it. That was the message that he gave the people.